In this video, we are going to discuss about constructor overloading in C++ or overloaded constructor in C++. Constructor overloading is the technique of defining multiple constructors with the same name but with different signatures. Here, signature mainly specifies two things: number of arguments and order of arguments. Let us assume that here we have a constructor which contains only one argument, that is integer. So here the order is also integer. Let us assume that we have two arguments, int, comma, float. So here the number of arguments are 2, whereas order of the arguments is int and float. So this is about what is a signature. Signature specifies number of arguments and order of arguments. Let us assume that we have one more constructor. This is the signature. So number of arguments are 2, but here what is the order? Float and int is the order. So this is the definition for constructor overloading. So constructor overloading is the process of defining multiple constructors with the same name but with different signatures. If we want to provide different implementations for a constructor, then we have to go for the constructor overloading. Let's see this program so that we can get the complete practical idea about constructor overloading. In this program, we are using iostream.h. Why? Because we are using cout object. Cout object is available in this iostream.h. Here we use a cout object. This object is available in iostream header file. Next, class, name of the class is rectangle. Next, private colon, under the private section we have two variables, length and breadth. Next to public section, we know that constructors should always be defined under the public section. Why? Because there is no need to create the constructor explicitly. Whenever an object is created, then automatically the corresponding constructor will be called. So if it is defined under the public section, then only that constructor will be called. If the constructor is defined under the private section, then we know that it is not possible to access the members of the private from the main method. So that's why we have to define the constructor under the public section. The name of the constructor must be same as the class name. So here we have a rectangle. So this is nothing but name of the constructor. So this constructor name and this class name should be the same. So constructor is nothing but a method only, a function only. So left parenthesis, right parenthesis. So this is nothing but default constructor. We know what is default constructor. It doesn't accept any parameters. So here we perform some initialization. Let length value 10, breadth value 20. Constructor is mainly useful in order to perform initialization of an object. If you want to initialize values to the variables, then we have to go for the constructor. So length is equal to 10, breadth is equal to 20. So here we have one more constructor. So this is nothing but parameterized constructor. Parameterized constructor accepts parameters. So name of the constructor is rectangle. It accepts one float parameter. Okay. So next we perform some initialization. The value of the length is 8, as well as the value of the breadth is 8. So length value is 8, as well as breadth is 8. Next, here we have one more parameterized constructor, but this constructor accepts how many float values? 2 float values. So float a comma float b. Next, we performed some initialization. So length is equal to a, breadth is equal to b. Next, this is nothing but a normal function. So return type of the function is float. Name of the function is area. So here we are calculating area. We know the formula for calculating area of the rectangle. So length into breadth. So return that value. Why? Because here the return type is float. So return length into breadth. So function is closed. So right curly brace semicolon. This is nothing but end of our class. Next, we have to define the main method. We know that execution of the main method. We know that execution of a program always starts from the main function. Here the return type of the main function is int. Why? Because if the program is successfully compiled and executed, main function returns a value called 0. So the last statement is return 0. Next, rectangle verb is a 1. So an object is created. So whenever an object is created, then memory will be allocated to the variables of the class. So in this class we have two variables. Name of the object is verb is able. So first variable is length, second variable is breadth. So for length and breadth, memory will be allocated. Next, whenever an object is created, then if there is a constructor definition, then automatically the corresponding constructor will be called. So here we have a constructor. So which constructor will be called here? Here after the object, we don't have any arguments. So the constructor which do not accept any parameters, that constructor will be called. So that means this constructor will be called. Why? Because this constructor doesn't accept any parameters. So whenever this object is created, memory will be allocated for the variables of the class such as length and breadth, and automatically the corresponding constructor will be called. So length value 10, breadth value 20. So length 10, breadth 20. So 10 will be stored in length, 20 will be stored in breadth. Next, cout less than slashing, zero argument constructor area is. Zero argument constructor area is. So this message will be printed. Zero argument constructor area is verb is a one dot area. So control goes to the area function. So return length into breadth. So for verb is a 1, length value 10, breadth value 20. So 10 into 20 means 200. So 200 will be retained and it will be displayed here. So zero argument constructor area is 200 will be printed. So next statement will be executed. Rectangle verb is a 2 of 30.0. So now whenever an object is created, then memory will be allocated to the variables of the class. So in the class we have two variables, length and breadth. So for length and breadth, memory will be allocated. Next, whenever an object is created, then if there is a constructor definition, then automatically the corresponding constructor definition will be executed. So which constructor will be called now? The constructor which is accepting one float value will be accepted now, will be called now. So 30.0, it is nothing but a float value. So this is the constructor, this is the constructor which accepts only one float value. So here what is the value? 30.0. So 30.0 will be passed to A. So length is equal to 30.0, breadth is equal to 30.0. So 30.0 will be stored in length as well as breadth. Next statement, one argument constructor area is. One argument, why? Because it is accepting only one argument. So one argument constructor area is, that message will be printed, obj2.area. So control goes to the area function, return length into breadth. In obj2, length value 30, breadth value 30. So 30 into 30 means 900. So 900.0 will be printed. Why? Because this is some float value. So next statement will be executed. Rectangle obj3 of 40.0. So obj3 object will be created. And here we have a constructor. So which constructor will be called now? The constructor which is accepting two float parameters will be executed. So this is such constructor which is accepting two float values. So what is length value now? Now here 40.0 will be stored in A, 50.0 will be stored in B. So now length will become 40.0, breadth will become 50.0. Okay, next statement, two argument constructor area is. So this message will be printed on the monitor, less than obj3 dot area. So control goes to the area function, return length into breadth. 40 into 50 means 2000. So 2000.0 will be printed. So this is about constructor overloading in C++.